So I am very pleased to introduce you to Dr. Chris Booth, and his talk is called "The Emperor Has No Clothes."
Thank you, Jack. 2 days in my medical residency had a profound impact on the course of my life, as I made a last-minute career decision to become an oncologist. As a resident, I was working in the chemotherapy clinics at Princess Margaret Hospital, and I witnessed firsthand the special bond between oncologist and patient. During those two fateful days, I saw sadness and joy. I also saw inspiration. Despite the most difficult of circumstances, there are moments which are uplifting as patients let go of the things in life which really do not matter and more fully embrace those which do. It is a privilege to walk with someone during this journey, and that's why I became a cancer doctor. Fast forward a decade, and I had another seminal career moment, this time driving through the narrow and crowded streets of South India in a minivan, making house calls with a palliative care team, but more on that later. Tonight, I will talk about the fundamental challenges facing cancer care. You may be surprised to hear the solutions will not come from a robot, a fancy new cancer medicine, or a brilliant scientist. The solutions that we need to implement, we can implement now. I have no doubt that scientific advances in the next 2 decades will transform care for some patients with some cancers. But I don't want to wait for breakthroughs that will happen in 20 years for some. We can have a huge and immediate impact now if we ensure that all patients get access to the treatments we already know work. It's critical we get this right. In the next 2 decades, global cancer rates will nearly double. About 1 in 2 Canadians will be diagnosed with the disease, and nearly 1 in 3 Canadians will die from cancer. While rates are rising in Canada, they are exploding in lower income and middle income countries. 2/3 of global cancer deaths will occur in these countries where we currently spend only 5% of global cancer resources. Some of the comments tonight that I make might be uncomfortable, especially for those of you who have walked the cancer journey. My intent is not that we second guess decisions we've made in the past. Rather, I seek to ask questions that we really must consider as we collectively imagine what a future cancer system could look like. In the classic folktale, a vain emperor is swindled by 2 people who pretend to be weavers. They dress him in a cloak, which is invisible, but the emperor is too proud. He does not want to appear foolish by saying he cannot see the cloth. Instead, he parades around town wearing nothing at all. The townspeople also don't want to appear foolish, and they play along with the charade, until a young child states the obvious: the emperor has no clothes. Oncologists alone will not solve the problems I'm about to outline. Parts of our cancer system have no clothes, but many cannot see. We need patients to help us find our way again. 3 challenges. 3 solutions. Here we go. Challenge number 1. The single biggest predictor of your outcome with cancer is the country in which you live. The gap in global cancer outcomes is largely driven by the fact that patients from poor neighborhoods or lower income countries are more likely to be diagnosed with advanced cancer rather than early stage disease, which can still be cured. And this is driven by the social determinants of health, poverty, gender inequity, lack of knowledge. One does not need to go overseas to see examples of disparities in care. A decade ago, our research team here at Queen's published a study in which we showed that despite having a universal public health system, the survival of patients with cancer in Ontario was strongly associated with socioeconomic status. These equity gaps are even more pronounced across the Indigenous communities of Canada. In 2015, my wife and I packed up our 4 young kids and moved to South India, where we lived during my sabbatical. I was based at a large government cancer hospital and would see patients in the morning and spend time in the afternoon with the epidemiology research unit. This experience had a profound impact on all of our family. We went home with many lessons learned, friendships, and many good memories, except for one day. The day when I thought it was a really good idea to buy homemade ice cream cones for the children from an old man on a bicycle who'd been sitting in the sun for hours. I'll spare you the gastrointestinal details of what subsequently transpired, but suffice it to say it was a long night for all of us in the Booth family. A common scenario I saw in the clinics of South India were young women with incurable cancer of the cervix and breast. This was difficult because many of these cancers could have been prevented with HPV vaccine or cured if diagnosed early. Instead, many of these women would die in months, and it would be a difficult death with limited access to palliative care and no pain medicine. This is heartbreaking when one considers for a few rupees per day they could have been kept comfortable with morphine. Together with our Indian colleagues, we studied these issues. We found that the survival of women with breast cancer in India is 65% compared to 90% in Canada. We also found that the single biggest predictor of whether a woman is diagnosed with curable or incurable cancer is her level of education. Challenge number two. Some of our cancer treatments really help patients. However, many have small benefits. You would think that any cancer treatment would help patients live longer and better. A few years ago, we looked into this and found that actually most new cancer medicines do not improve overall survival or quality of life. Instead, these days, the most common benefit of a new cancer medicine is shrinks tumors on a CAT scan for a period of time. Even amongst those drugs that help patients live longer, the gains are modest. On average, these drugs help people live for an extra 2 or 3 months. Now, I don't mean to minimize or detract from the value of a few extra months of life for anyone, but one does need to remember that for some patients, this comes at a real cost to their quality of life with side effects, and perhaps even the loss of some meaningful time. Time spent pursuing cancer treatment in our waiting rooms, emergency departments, or chemo units is time that cannot be spent fishing, traveling, or visiting loved ones. This time trade-off becomes most difficult near the end of life when time is short and the benefits of our treatments are often very small. Challenge number three. We cannot ignore the price of cancer medicines. The biggest problem with marginal cancer therapies is the harm that they cause to our patients, but we also need to consider the risks to our health system. The average annual price for a new cancer medicine is $150,000 US. A few years ago, our research team looked into this and we found that there's no association between how well the treatment works and its price. If anything, we found the drugs with the smallest benefit had the largest price. Now, I'm not an economist, but that system is broken. To put this in perspective, years ago, I was sitting at a major cancer meeting in an auditorium, thousands of oncologists. There was anticipation in the air. There was applause. A famous researcher was up on the stage presenting the results of a clinical trial of a cancer drug that we knew for some patients caused very severe rash and diarrhea. To much applause, the scientists presented the results of the trial. This cancer drug helped patients live longer. It improved survival by 10 days. Incredibly, many countries in the world adopted this therapy with a cost of $100,000. This might be an extreme example, but I bring it up because I'm sure all of us can imagine how those funds and resources could have been used to help the same patients in a more meaningful way, supporting their physical, emotional, and social needs. Our focus on new technologies and medicines that are expensive with small benefits has another threat. It threatens our ability to ensure the treatments and medicine we know that make a big difference are available to all. Just last month, our research group published a study with the World Health Organization in which we asked 1,000 oncologists in 82 countries which treatments were most important and provide the largest benefits to their patients. The most common drugs that were on that list when we got the data back, were generally older chemotherapy and hormone drugs. Drugs we know that have large benefits for patients and they cost dollars per week. These doctors also wanted some of our newer and expensive medicines, but it was those that we know have a big benefit. Tragically, the second part of the study found that despite most of these high priority medicines being generic and inexpensive, they remain unaffordable to the vast majority of patients in the world. This means patients either do not get access to these medicines or their family will go into debt for generations in order to get them. I raise these issues tonight because our patients expect better. I also believe it is our patients that will help us find the solutions. Solution one, we can learn from our patients. My greatest teachers of the art of oncology are my patients and their families. Several of them are here tonight. Patients can remind oncologists what matters and ensure the treatments we deliver have real benefit. We've just completed a study in which we asked our patients who have incurable cancer, we asked them directly, how do you balance the potential benefits of treatment versus the risks of side effects and quality of life? The results were incredibly insightful and challenged many assumptions held by the medical community. Patients can tell when the emperor has no clothes, even when their doctors cannot. Our patients can also help us improve our communication skills. Here's an example. It's quite common in the initial consultation with a patient for the topic of prognosis to come up. And usually we're pretty clear in telling patients if their disease is not curable. A few months go by, we start chemotherapy, and then we do the first CAT scan. The CAT scan comes back showing the tumor is shrinking, and we celebrate it as good news, and it is encouraging, and the patient is upbeat, and we all feel good. And it does mean the patient probably will do better than some of the median survival statistics we talked about a few months ago. But I often worry that these conversations the patient might interpret as meaning the conversation we had 3 months ago about incurable disease may no longer hold true. As you can imagine, these are really complicated discussions. Oncologists struggle with this. How do we balance hope and reality? How and when should we give bad news? How do we frame prognosis and how often do we come back to it? We need to fully engage patients and the patient voice in all of the research we do so that they can teach us these important lessons. Solution number two, we need to take back the power from drug companies and the media. The current cancer system is heavily influenced by the pharmaceutical industry. Now, a lot of our really good treatments come from drug companies, and we need those, and those are important partners. However, I worry the companies now control the system rather than being an important player in a system driven by the needs of our patients. Our group has recently found that 90% of cancer clinical trials are funded by drug companies. Not surprisingly, almost every clinical trial in cancer is testing a new and expensive cancer medicine. Now, these trials are important. We need this research. This is the treatments of tomorrow. But we also need other research. We need government agencies and other funders to step up so that we can answer questions that also matter to patients. What is the role of diet, exercise, meditation? How can we improve our communication skills? How can we identify treatments with fewer side effects that are more convenient with better quality of life for our patients? Our community also has to have more open conversations about how these companies influence physicians and even some patient support groups through funded lectures and conferences and cash payments. Even the media is unwittingly contributing to some of these problems by overhyping every new cancer medicine on the front page of the newspaper. And this creates unrealistic expectations for patients and families and pressures our policymakers to approve and pay for treatments that might not be helpful. The combined influence of the industry and the media creates a cancer system where the emperor is nearly naked, but many cannot see. Solution three, we can learn from other health systems. The traditional paradigm of global health is that high-income countries teach low-income countries what to do, and then we send money. However, we can learn just as much from these low-resource health systems as they can learn from us. We just need the humility to recognize it. I've had the privilege of working with Palliamendia for the last 6 years. This is a world-renowned NGO based in India that delivers palliative care. The founder, Dr. Raj Gopal, has become a dear friend and visited Queens twice to teach, lecture, and inspire. Raj and I fondly remember at his last visit when my 8-year-old taught him and his wife how to make a snowman. Of course, my daughter had no idea she was throwing snowballs with a really famous Indian physician who that month would be nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. Traveling by minivan through the narrow and crowded streets of India, I made house calls with Raj, a palliative care nurse and a social worker. Palliamendia pioneered the concept of community-led models of palliative care. In this model, doctors and nurses attend to the complex medical needs of patients, but much of the day-to-day caring, compassion, and visit is delivered by trained volunteer members of the community. A system like this could have such power in Canada and benefit so many of our isolated patients and have remarkable benefits for the volunteers who would experience this rich form of human connection. I'll share one more story from my time in India, which illustrates something that I call the global paradox of patient-centered care. Any of you who've ever stepped foot in a government hospital in India will know on initial impression it's total chaos, and in many ways appears to be the antithesis of patient-centered care. Patients have traveled overnight by train and bus. They wait for hours in a waiting room with hundreds of patients waiting to see the doctor. But there's some elements of that system that are more patient-centered than our own. Let's imagine a patient with colon cancer in Canada. After a few months of GI bleeding, they get a colonoscopy. Someone tells them they have cancer. Then the waiting starts. They get referred to a surgeon. It takes a couple weeks, they see the surgeon. The surgeon refers them to the cancer center to see me, a chemotherapy doctor, and my radiation partner. It takes a couple more weeks to come to the cancer center, 2 separate consultations, 2 oncologists, 2 separate days, probably 2 separate parking tickets. More back and forth, liver scan, PIC line, radiation planning. Finally, weeks later, the patient starts chemotherapy and radiation. At the hospital where I worked in India, patients would show up with no appointment and they would be seen that day. They might wait all day in a chaotic waiting room, but eventually they would see the surgeon. The surgeon would then walk them down the hall to see the oncologist. A liver scan, radiation planning scan, PIC line would all happen on the same day. A few days later, chemotherapy and radiation would start. Now, which system is truly more patient-centered? I recognize my comments tonight have been critical of our current system, but I am hopeful we can change. Every week as an oncologist, I'm privileged to see the power of the human spirit, deep connection, and the ability of medicine to improve the lives of our patients. The oncology community needs to mobilize and initiate a global movement of health justice. Where someone lives should not influence their cancer outcome. And patients in all health systems, high income, low income, in between, all of them deserve compassionate care, clear communication, and treatments that make a real difference. In closing, I will offer a few parting thoughts about how we can create a better cancer system. We need more honest communication. We need to advocate for treatments with real benefit. We need to recalibrate our priorities. And finally, all of us need to speak up when the emperor has no clothes. Thank you.